Thank you. I'd like to recognize the tremendous effort and put into this study and analysis by the five students. I would like to just mention that although the Philippines, with a population of about 98 million, the CIA says 102 million, is in about 7,000 islands, but to simplify it, the 11 biggest islands comprise 94% of the population and 94% of the territory. Second, I would like to mention that within the 333 years of Spanish colonial rule, there were more than 200 revolts of the Filipino people of varying sizes, which became an accumulated revolutionary tradition, which carried over in the struggle for national independence in 1896, which became victorious, but the U.S. came and put on its, imposed its colonial rule up to 1946, and then an independence in name was given, but the U.S. has kept control over the economy, the politics, the military, and the culture in the Philippines up to now. So, as pointed out, the youth problem is one of the peasant and farm workers' desire for land, which is monopolized by big landlords and the foreign corporations. So right now, it would be the big landlords and the big comprador bourgeoisie connected with the U.S. and other foreign corporations, which comprise less than 1% of the population, who control the country, while the great majority, about 99%, are suffering under a system of exploitation and oppression. For example, Dole Philippines is a U.S. company. A study by the trade unions in the Philippines brought out that the exploitation was so intense that the workers got back only a salary that comprised 53 seconds of their 8-hour work. So the super profits went to this company. That goes also for the mining corporations and other corporations. And a student of this university, Niels Freiriks, went to the Philippines in March and stayed there for 2 months, integrated with the peasants and farm workers, and saw that the problem of landlessness was a huge problem, and that is also one of the main problems that are taken up in the peace negotiations. I would just like to add that there have been 12 peace agreements that have been signed since 1992 up to 2004. The Norwegian government plays the role of facilitator, not mediator, but facilitator. And major agreements like the Hague Joint Declaration signed in The Hague in 1992 is a basic framework agreement which says that the two parties do not impose its political authority, its constitution on the other. So there's a system of parity and reciprocity which allows the peace talks to continue. I have copies here of this, the Hague Joint Declaration signed in 1992. Now, there have been great efforts to come up with reforms in land reform, also in other questions of human rights. So a human rights agreement was signed in the Hague also in 1998. There is a book on all the 12 agreements that have been signed, which we are willing to leave in your library, so you could check it. And then the negotiating party, the National Democratic Front, represents 17 revolutionary organizations, including, of course, the Communist Party of the Philippines, the New People's Army, workers' organizations, organizations of peasants, also organizations of teachers, writers, scientists and technologists, government workers, Christians for national liberation, Moro Islamic Liberation Organization, and so many other organizations, 17. So that gives a kind of unity of this negotiating party, which represents the movement that is operating in 110 guerrilla areas throughout the country with programs of health, of literacy, of land reform, and also settlement of disputes, self-defense. So it is a huge organization with an armed strength, with discipline, and also with its social programs, so that the New People's Army's main work right now is to defend the people's organizations, their areas, their programs from attacks of the military. But of course, the aim is to have national and social liberation. I just mentioned that in 2005, the NDF proposed to the government and with a copy to the Royal Norwegian government, a proposal for immediate just peace. This is a proposal for alliance and truce with the government of the Republic of the Philippines, if they wish to have a truce while negotiations are being carried out, agreements are forged on the roots of the armed conflict. So I will leave it at that, and maybe Professor Sison would like to add something.
I would like to add just a few comments. I appreciate the students who made the presentation of the armed conflict in the Philippines between the Philippine government and the National Democratic Front of the Philippines. I see that they have done their library work very well. They have read available books, and they also have a good reflection of the main ideas that run through the establishment media. And I also noticed that some readings have been made of the revolutionary literature in the Philippines, and I could only stress that more work probably has to be done in simply reading what appears in the websites of the CPP, the Communist Party of the Philippines, the New People's Army, the National Democratic Front of the Philippines. The website is Philippine Revolution, www.philippinerevolution.net. I think scholarship that really advances knowledge takes into account what is available knowledge in the libraries. That's what I call frozen knowledge. And you add to that what you can get, the latest that you can get from the information dissemination made by the parties involved, especially the revolutionary movement. If you would like to present the very essence of the armed conflict, it is in the nature of the establishment, you know, to react, simply react, and to try to conserve the dominant interest. But it is the revolutionary movement that points out the change that needs to be made. And I would say that to understand the armed conflict, you have to have a deep going knowledge of the class analysis of Philippine society by which the revolutionary movement. On top of class analysis, it was well pointed out that the history of colonization has much to do with the ongoing conflict in the Philippines. The Philippines is still a semi-colonial country. It is nominally independent, but the United States, among capitalist powers, still controls the Philippines economically, financially, politically, and even culturally. When it comes to the modern accoutrements of culture, the US is dominant. And but inside the Philippines, you have the interrelationship of classes. The CPP tries to represent what is considered the most progressive, productive, and political force in the Philippines. Just as in the old democratic revolution, the class that was supposed to be most progressive was in the lead, the main, to say, the bourgeoisie. And then that was defeated and then co-opted by a bigger bourgeois power, US imperialism. And so the Philippine Revolution has been undertaken by the advance of what is called the World Proletarian Revolution. And even as the Philippines not so industrialized, the working class is still limited in size. The working class represents what is the most progressive force, and it is a force that goes forward, even towards the extent of socialism. So the revolutionary movement confronts the existing problems of foreign monopoly capitalism, domestic feudalism, and bureaucratic capitalism. They use the terms of the movement. And for a certain class to lead a revolutionary process, that does not have to be the biggest class. The bourgeoisie was very small. In the old democratic revolution in the Philippines, there was not even the development of manufacturing as in Europe. No? And the bourgeoisie in the Philippines was involved people who arose from the development of some amount of commerce and some amount of education and the like. So it did not come from any industrial or manufacturing advancement. In the Philippines, you have also small leading class. It has its weaknesses because we don't have basic industries that make the country industrial. But anyway, it is an agency for change, and it can link up with similar revolutionary forces abroad. Now, but of course, it seems like, you know, the prospect of socialism is overtaken by developments that involve the reversal of earlier socialist revolutions. But it should be amazing to many that the Philippine Revolution, with its current objectives of trying to achieve national liberation and democracy, and it, with its prospect of aiming for socialism, continues to exist and advance in the Philippines. At this moment, the two sides in the Philippines are about to destroy each other. One side is trying to apply the US guide to counterinsurgency. It is Oakland, Bayanihan is supposed to be the same as Oakland, Bantaylayo, Arroyo. The difference is that the dog has a prettier color, or it is made to appear more attractive. It goes this way. Military operations are now called peace and development operations. Can you beat that, no? How clever. And then every unit of the armed forces, reactionary armed forces, in every level of command, has a human rights desk. That is not to promote human rights of the people, especially the civilians, but it is a, the office serves to keep the military from being pinned down for by accusations of human rights violations. So that's how clever it is. And if you study deeply this U.S. guy, the important thing for the reactionary forces in the Philippines, specifically the Aquino regime, is to be good at governance, delivery of services, economic reconstruction and development, security reform, information to beat the revolutionary movement. All that it has to do is to be good at those functions, but unfortunately it cannot really perform those functions effectively. And anyway, there is a need to mount peace and reconciliation by way of making more effective the triad, so-called triad operations of the military. The triad operations are psychological warfare, civil military operations, and combat operations. Now, the other side has a plan, sort of destroying the other side, but it goes towards destroying the other side ultimately. Okay,
and so comments, so we can have a break afterwards. Anyone can discuss further.
The side of the revolutionary movement is to advance from strategic defensive to strategic stalemate in the people's war. Now, it will be an interesting question. Why? With two sides seeking to destroy each other, why are these negotiations at work? Why are peace negotiations running? Why is it that both sides are also pushing the peace negotiations? That would be an interesting subject to cover.
Yes, thank you very much for your reflections. We'll now have a 5 to 10 minutes break, so we can all think about what the guest has said, and we will start with the interview. In the end, you also have time to ask some questions. Thank you.